He has suffered with you. He went through everything you went through. And now, he has come here. He is very close, listening to every word we say. He doesn't realize he's already a part of the never-ending story. Just as he is sharing all your adventures, others are sharing his.
Others are sharing his.
They were with him when he hid from the boys in the bookstore. They were with him when he took the book with the oar and symbol on the cover, in which he's reading his own story right now.
The NeverEnding Story is a movie about a boy reading a book based on a book about a boy reading a book. Not only does the main character of the movie find out he is in the book, but you find out you are in the movie. The boy, named Bastian, borrows a book from the bookstore. The bookstore owner told him this was a special book, one where you're actually in the story and face the same dangers the characters do. The book is special, as the story of the book changes depending on the reader. Don't you think it was a coincidence that the hero of the story was a little boy just like Bastian? Even Bastian was surprised when he read it. When the bookstore owner read the book, I have little doubt the story changed for him as well. Perhaps the protagonist was a bookstore owner in that particular version. It's even implied that the Fantasia in the story comes from Bastian's imagination, as he was always daydreaming about it and drawing horses and other animals, and possibly even mythical animals that we see in the movie. Fantasia is the setting of the book, and we find out that there is a force destroying Fantasia and practically erasing it along with its inhabitants. The force, known as the Nothing, seems to be closing in on the world at an alarming rate, and some of its people gather at the capital, the Ivory Tower, where the Empress of the realm resides, to figure out a way to stop the Nothing. We learn that the only one who can stop the Nothing is a boy named Atreyu, who is given a magical talisman called the Auron, which also adorns the cover of the real book. He must leave his weapons behind and go alone. This is key, because in the real world, in order to save the fantasy world, Bastian had to make it all the way to the climax of the story to complete his task and save the world. This wouldn't have happened if the story was boring to Bastian, so he had to be sucked in and entertained enough to make it to the end of the story. That was why Atreyu was told to leave his weapons behind and go alone. Why couldn't he bring even a knife, which could have helped defend himself from entities like Gamork, or bring a sidekick like the guy on the racing snail? The reason is because it makes a more compelling story for Bastian. It adds danger, uncertainty, vulnerability. It was similar to the real world, when Bastian had no weapons when the boys attacked him, giving Atreyu an army of supporters, an army which Bastian did not have in the real world, having lost his mother and seemingly few if any friends, and so that wouldn't pull Bastian into the story. Atreyu struggles to cross Fantasia, his horse dies, he nearly drowns, and only by luck meets up with the Luck Dragon, who rescues him and takes him close to the Southern Oracle, an entity which should know what it is that Atreyu has to do. But it's actually the most important part of the movie right before he meets the Southern Oracle, when he has to go through two gates, the first of which was two inward-facing guardians who could see straight into the would-be passerby's heart to see if the person thought he was worthy enough. It was a test of confidence that his heart was good. The second gate was worse. It was a mirror which showed a person who they really are. When Atreyu makes it through the gate and gazes into it, he sees the image of Bastian reading the book. Remember, this is a mirror which shows you who you really are. So in Atreyu's case, he finds out that he is a character in the book, in a book, currently existing in the mind of a boy reading. This was all written in the book Bastian was reading, and it was that moment that he had about enough. But he ventures on, as does Atreyu, having passed the test and handled himself well. He was a character in the story, but he knew he had a mission to fulfill. He was sent to find a way to save Fantasia, and so he had to go on. All of this, Atreyu's adventure and danger, the characters, and even the two antagonists, which were the Nothing and the giant wolf Gamork, keep the reader enthralled to get him to the end of the story. Finally, when Atreyu gets to the Childlike Empress, he learns that he succeeded in bringing the Earthling child. Simply by adventuring across Fantasia, going through danger and almost dying, it was enough to get the reader to the end. She knows what Bastion must do. Almost as a test of the power of his imagination and his faith in Fantasia, he must call out the Empress's new name. She knows Bastion has already chosen it, which was the name of his late mother, but did Bastion have the courage to suspend his disbelief that it was only a story, and would he shout out her new name with the understanding that he is really saving Fantasia? Notice again here how the Empress stares directly at you when she implores Bastion, save them. She says Bastion's name several times. That could be symbolic. While the name Bastion could be short for Sebastian, could also reference the definition of Bastion as something or someone preserving or protecting some quality, as if you are the last bastion of imagination and fantasy, which is what Bastion is in this story. Bastion barely makes it, but does what he must do. He finds himself within the story, or finds himself in a kind of in-between place between real and fantasy, and he meets the Empress, who gives him the last remaining grain of sand, which is the only remnants of the once vast and beautiful world. Let me reiterate what the Empress says. We are mentioned in the movie as the ones who were with Bastion when he escaped from the bullies and took the book. Being that it's a never-ending story, the implication is that something is watching us. Does it mean that we too are characters in a movie? I can't answer that, but maybe we see glimpses of the magic mirror gate when we have near-death or out-of-body experiences and experience other phenomena. Maybe, as the title of the movie suggests, the level of this story, that is the layers of reality, are never ending. As they say in the movie, that's another story. The main takeaway from the movie is that your dreams are keeping your Fantasia from disappearing, as well as Bastion's, and you must keep your hopes and dreams alive. In Bastion's story, he had to give the Empress a new name. In your story, what would it be that saves Fantasia? No matter what it may be, in the real world, you do have to keep your feet mostly on the ground. That is, when you're not doing what you dream.